18th, 1982, started out as a typical day in Plan de Sanchez, the small and tranquil Mayan village in the highlands of Guatemala. There was no reason for anyone to anticipate the carnage that day would bring. Like many other Mayan villages, Plan de Sanchez experienced a brutal massacre by the Guatemalan military, part of a bloody campaign to wipe out a small armed insurgency. At least 130 women and children were murdered that day.
Subieron esa patrulla de ejército y las fueron.
The group of soldiers and civil defense patrollers came up here and brought everyone they encountered coming back from the market. Once they got here to Plan de Sanchez, they started intercepting all the people coming along. They didn't let anyone go by. They raped 12 girls, 12 to 14 years old. And they tortured them. When they had everybody here, and my sister's house was full, they threw grenades in the house and opened fire. They began their massacre in the afternoon, and they didn't stop shooting till 9 at night.
Pararon el disparo.
12 years later, the 130 victims of the Plan de Sanchez massacre were exhumed by a team of forensic anthropologists. Victoria Sanford is a U.S. anthropologist collaborating with the team.
In this grave, when I started working on it, we thought there were maybe 6 or 7 different skeletons, and there ended up being 18 in the grave. And in amongst those 18, most of them were women and children. There were a couple of young men who were maybe 17 years old. There were 2. There were a lot of burned skeletons that we were unable to identify exactly count-wise how many there were, because the bones were very damaged and burned up. And there were shadows of ashes at the bottom of the grave that had the form of a skeleton, but not complete skeletons. At one point, one of the first skeletons that I excavated here with the team was the skeleton of a woman. We knew it was a woman because her plastic shoes were still there and because of the hair. And I was excavating, taking the dirt off, and I came upon a shawl. And I thought it was perhaps a shawl that had been wrapped around the skeleton. The clothing stays if it's got a polyester content, even though the body dissolves and decomposes, the clothing stays with the bones. And I was going to lift off the shawl, and I realized it was tied around the woman. And when I opened it up, there was the skeleton of a baby inside.
When we arrived here the next day, we didn't know what to do. We were dead as well. No longer would we be able to see any of our killed loved ones.
Que no miramos ninguno ya de los fallecidos. Ya los conocimos. Como eran.
I loved my family so much when they were alive.
Y de repente,
I knew them, what they were like. Then suddenly they were gone from me, or rather, they were taken from me.
No los quitaron más que tú. Y ese era lo que...
We were left suffering.
Quedamos nosotros.
Never again able to look at the faces of our family that we'd lost.
Ya no miramos. La cara jamás de los... nuestra familia que las perdimos.
Throughout this small Central American country, people, most of them Mayans, are digging up what are known as clandestine cemeteries, searching for the remains of their assassinated loved ones. There are hundreds of these mass graves throughout the country, where Guatemalan security forces and paramilitary death squads dumped tens of thousands of bodies, perhaps over 100,000.
And that when the military says they killed guerrilla in these places, in these villages, they didn't. They killed women, and they killed children, and they killed elderly people. And even if there were young men who were killed, they didn't deserve to die either. No one deserves to be killed in the way that these people were killed and piled into graves as if they were animals. And what these people are fighting for is what everyone deserves, is to know where their loved ones are, to be able to place them in a grave with their religious ceremonies, just as we would all want for our people, and also for them to be able to demonstrate clearly that the government hasn't been telling the truth and that the people who died here were families.
Traditionally, Guatemalan Mayans farmed corn, beans, and squash in the fertile highlands, but they were forced off their land by an oligarchy who created vast coffee, cotton, sugar, and banana plantations. 95% of native Guatemalans became landless. Many were forced to work for slave wages on large plantations. In 1952, President Jacobo Arbenz initiated a land reform policy to put farmland in the hands of Guatemala's starving peasants. But those reforms threatened the interests of the U.S. company United Fruit, the largest single landowner in Guatemala. In 1954, the United States, in a CIA-sponsored coup, overthrew Arbenz. Since then, Guatemalans have lived under a series of governments dominated by a military which has used death squads to silence calls for change. The violence and poverty led to widespread dissent and the formation of a small armed insurgency in the countryside. The Guatemalan military responded with a genocidal campaign against the Mayans. In the early 80s, the Guatemalan military used scorched earth tactics to discourage civilian support of the small guerrilla insurgency, burning villages and fields and torturing and slaughtering the Mayan villagers. On March 13, 1982, Rio Negro, a quiet township above the town of Rabinal, fell victim to the repression so prevalent throughout the lush countryside of Guatemala. The horror and brutality which was visited upon the 225 Mayan families in Rio Negro that day is difficult to comprehend.
What followed from that massacre, like all the other massacres in Guatemala, was close to 10 to 12 years of silence. You couldn't even mourn your dead because of the repression. And if in a small community you were seen crying publicly, that would indicate to perhaps someone working with the army that you were a family member of a killed person. It made you suspect yourself. And so the repression in the country got to such a point that you couldn't even mourn in public.
But that silence has been broken. Despite the history of violence, poverty, and racism, Guatemalans continue to organize and work for their human rights. And particularly at this time, they are demanding that the truth be told about the past. The mass graves at Rio Negro were unearthed in 1993 by a Guatemalan forensic team. The skeletons of 177 women and children were exhumed, documented, then properly buried here, just outside of Rabinal. Survivors of the massacre and their children built this monument with the aid of the Campaign for Peace and Life, an ecumenical solidarity group from the United States. Engraved on the monument are the names of the victims, along with the story of how they died. Above the story are the words, "Christ tortured and massacred in the village of Rio Negro."
My wife is buried here.
My two sons are buried here. One was named Enriquete, and the other Antonio Chen Iboy. I grieve their deaths. They were innocent. It hurts me because they were innocent. My son was only 6 years old when they killed him, and he already knew how to read and write because I was a teacher in the community. And my pain will never go away. I can never get out of my mind what happened. My wife is 6 months pregnant.
And I'm working with a number of different organizations, writing articles and trying to bring to light to the international community the extent of the atrocities that have taken place here in Guatemala. They're ongoing to a certain extent, but particularly those that took place in the early 1980s, the late 70s. And this case here of Rio Negro is an example of that. And this particular one on Rio Negro, on March 13th, they took 107 women and 70 children, so 177 people in total, and they took them up to a place high up in the mountains, just out surrounding this area, and they murdered them there in cold blood. The next day, in the following days, it was reported by the army that it had been a confrontation with guerrilla fighters, subversives. But of course, there was no subversives there whatsoever. There was no guerrilla fighters. It was just unarmed women and children. A number of the women were pregnant at the time. And when the Guatemalan forensic team did its exhumation, they found the fetuses of baby in the stomachs of their mothers.
I'm grieving because the army has destroyed so many human lives. We all have a right to live here on this earth. God has given life to us. Only He should be able to take it away. He made the earth and heaven and man. Well, how is it possible for men to destroy so many lives? My sisters are here, my cousins, everyone. I grieve for their lives. They were murdered on the 13th of March, and they were innocent.
The monument was dedicated on March 12, 1995, on the 13th anniversary of the Rio Negro massacre. The commemoration ceremony was attended by Guatemalan and international human rights activists, the massacre survivors and their families, and Mayan and Catholic priests. After 12 years, the silence had been broken.
This place is for the unborn children, for the children who were small. This tells the story of the village of Rio Negro, which suffered a massacre. No one should suffer a massacre and be forgotten, be buried without names, without an image of who the people were and what happened, of what the truth is. For me, this monument means a lot for those who come here, so they can realize that here you'll find your grandparents, your brothers, your cousins, your uncles. It's proof of what happened in Rio Negro.
Here, the history is written.
Because I think that if we want to create democracy in places where there's been authoritarian rule, if we want to make sure that there are democratic forms of government, the only way that that can be achieved is if the truth is known about what happened in the past. And I firmly believe that the only way to stop massacres from happening again is to make sure that they're recorded, in the same way that survivors of concentration camps in Germany, the survivors of the Holocaust, say we must remember because it can never happen again.
The exhumation process is not ending, but beginning. As a member of the international forensic team said, not even with 30 years of work and 30 forensic teams will there be enough resources or time to exhume all the murdered in Guatemala. International solidarity and support is crucial if the people of Guatemala are to continue to actively confront the past, commemorate the victims, and make those who committed the atrocities accountable.